denied by the hospital either access to her spouse, or she had warned him about a drug that her spouse was allergic to, and they ended up using it anyways.
Yes, right.
Because as far as the people who were working at the hospital were concerned, she had no say.
Right. Right, and they were trying to tell, they were trying to, she was trying to tell the hospital staff, don't give her this particular drug.
Started with an A.
Yes. But it's a horrible story,
Yeah.
You know, so, you know, when people, you know, in our audience perhaps are, you know, thinking, well, what does it really matter? You know, getting married or not getting married. You know, what consequences is it of it? You know, well, if you want a relationship, why don't you just live together? But you know, the way that the laws are defined, and the way that the Defense of Marriage Act, in particular, the way that it was used for political advantage by the Republicans in the last administration. Has very real, very tangible effects for people in our community.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's just not right.
Yeah. And it's the in the case of this woman or this couple, it's fine to say that, well, certainly you can take a lawyer, you can go back to the hospital and you can sue them. You know. But what a great deal of tort reform. You know, how many quote unquote frivolous lawsuits would you get rid of if you would just upfront recognize these people as the legal spouse? You may not recognize them in your state. If they move there, they're not going to file joint state returns. But at least when they're traveling through, the irony is, like, with a friend of mine has lived in a lot of different states, and she was telling me that the driver's license test in different states is dramatically different what they test for. Dramatically different. Yet once you have one, you're allowed to drive in any of them. Even if you wouldn't have passed the test, had you taken it?
Sure. I still have, I had a motorcycle in California, and I have not lived in California now for 14, 15, 16 years now. I still have a motorcycle endorsement on my driver's license.
Right.
So,
on
I mean,
your Connecticut driver's license.
On my Connecticut driver's license.
Yeah, but when it comes to marriage, there's such a strong feeling of not even not even acknowledging those contracts, those out-of-state contracts. That it's a lot more. A lot of times in the media, what you hear covered are the social stigmas that, you know, calling it marriage means something different than calling it a civil union or a domestic partnership. That there's a different social aspect to it, and that's true. But the real important part is, as you were saying, are the legal aspects. There are real serious legal complications that come into play when you don't recognize that union.
And I'm not exactly sure, certainly a good point, but I'm not sure that I agree with you that there really is such a, that there really is such a big deal about, about the word marriage. I mean, what does, my having a marriage, how does that impose on anybody else's marriage? And if there's anybody listening, I would really like for you to call, and explain to me how, anyone's same-sex marriage does anything to your marriage.
If there's some notion that because you and Rocco enjoy kissing each other, that someone else's marriage is somehow lessened, I would suggest you look at the people who are engaged in that marriage and not look at the people outside it.
Right. Well, if your marriage is so is so ephemeral, slipshod that that a couple of homosexuals or bisexuals getting those same privileges, it makes you feel like your marriage has been, sullied or dirtied. Well, I think you really need to look at your marriage a lot more closely.
Right. Sure. What I was referring to was just the media coverage. Right. There's a lot of media coverage around Prop 8 and the California laws, and what I've seen covered is not necessarily the real meat tangible problems of not recognizing, you know, state by state. What I've seen the media cover is, well, it's just not right. Much more, as you were saying, a fear, much more shallow arguments, frankly.
Well, that's because they're talking with people whose lives really aren't affected by same-sex marriage.
Sure. We actually have a phone call.
Yay.
Great.
Good evening, NLC Trans. You're on the air.
Hello.
Hello.
I'm calling up to tell you that it just doesn't seem I'm all for gay marriage, and it seems like this country, just because it isn't politically correct, that's why things that have absolute great common sense. We can sit here and talk for 10 years, make complete common sense about any subject matter, but because it ain't politically correct, and they think they might lose a vote. Now, what do you think? Should every gay person that's in the closet come out and never pay taxes in the state of Connecticut right now? Because we are getting discriminated against. We are getting discriminated against anybody. I don't care if you're straight or gay.
Sure.
You're still being discriminated against, and we have to fight back. And I don't know how you fight back legally, because common sense is not prevailing.
True. And I would not suggest that anybody not pay their taxes. That would get them into deep trouble. And
I'll jump on state. Well, I'll just go on state. There you go.
Okay.
What are we going to do? How else are you going to win this battle?
Well, I certainly think your suggestion about coming out actually has a lot of merit to it. I think there's a lot of value in people coming out and saying, look, I'm your neighbor. I work with you.
We don't have to say it was straight or gay. We just have to stick together. Because right now, they're running us. We're not running them.
Sure.
That's
true. There's nothing in any political system that we have control of as an American citizen today.
All right. And civil disobedience and protest are wonderful things, but we
have to shoot you.
But
like at Kennedy, at Kent State. Yeah, it already happened in America. They're worried about what's going on in China. They already did it in America.
Yeah.
Am I right?
There can be a lot of hypocrisy in our government between the ideals they espouse and the foreign policies they support. That's true.
So what are they driving us to?
The important thing is to have a voice. You're not going to affect any change if you can't step out and have that voice. You know,
but with that voice, the people ain't listening. That is the problem in this country today. Nobody in the lead is listening to the people. That we can have 10 million of us go out there and say, we believe this. And they'll do the exact opposite if they think they'll lose a damn vote for it.
That's sick.
That's crazy. That ain't even America. Right. That ain't what my grandfather
But we do
vote.
World
War II for.
What I would argue, though, is that you're not going to change the public's mind. And the public, when you get enough of the public behind you, you have the force to influence them, because then they're afraid of not voting in your favor. And the only way that you're going to turn the opinion of the public is to get out there and show them that we're not scary people,
right.
That we're very normal,
right.
And that you really do want us to be treated equally.
That's right.
It's really about winning hearts and minds.
Yeah.
And I think this is a great call, and thank you, very much for the call. But there is an aspect of this that is about taxation without representation.
That's true.
My husband and I are not taxed at the same rate that another couple with the exact same income, the exact same mortgage. We're not, it really is taxation without representation.
Yes.
Tea party. I'm just ashamed at my country for not being able to be heard, even when the majority, because common sense is common sense. And if you make
you'll also find common sense is not that common.
Maybe every college should.
That is so true.
Maybe every college should.